Thank you very much for the invitation. For me, it's a big honor and also, I think, responsibility, because what I'm trying to do is to let you involve more in the reality of the family. Because as the president of the Family Association, what my experience is to have the chance to speak with all the level of the society, from the bottom to up society. And this is very useful, but this experience to be shared, and I hope to be able to share with you this experience. So I would like to use, okay, thank you. So the okay, as it is written in the book of Genesis, it is not good for man to be alone, is it good for families to be alone. The family cannot be isolated like a monad. Pope Francis told us when he received us in making in the 20th anniversary of the founding of the European Federation of the Catholic Family Association. As the Pope underlined, families need to go out from themselves. They need to dialogue and to encounter others in order to build a unity that is not uniformity and that can generate progress and advance the common good. To respond to this need, Catholic family networks provide a framework of mutual assistance and action united to the pastors and with the strength of the evangelical announcement. For more than a century, family associations all over Europe have been established to organize, above all, mutual aid between neighboring families. In France, in the 1920s, rural families gathered to buy a washing machine that passed from family to a family during the week. Later, they did the same with television, which they gathered to watch together during family evenings. In responding to concrete needs, family associations facilitate exchange, dialogue, sharing. They contribute to the project that God has entrusted to the family of making the world more domestic and favoring a strong injection of family spirit into our communities. This is Amoris Laetitia. The family association, therefore, is naturally called to respond to a new and evolving needs in accordance with the specific times and places in which they arrive. Often, family associations meet needs well before they are provided by the public, so-called welfare systems. In Poland, for example, family associations help large families find homes and create networks of family-friendly local authority. In Austria, they utilize their networks to welcome migrants and refugees. In Czech Republic, they come to the aid of young mothers in difficulty, as well as parents with disabled children, and so on. Since the very beginning, family networks have been concerned first and foremost with education, because schools cannot do everything. Too often, parents find themselves deprived of means to take on the breadth of the task entrusted to them, since, as Pope reminds us in Amoris Laetitia, that the overall education of children is a most serious duty and at the same time a primary right of parents. This is not just a task or a burden, but an essential right that parents are called to defend and of which no one may claim to deprive them. In other words, it is a question of munus. It is communion, duty, intrinsically linked to the experience of motherhood and fatherhood. The educational sphere does not merely concern itself with the transmission of a knowledge. Rather, it bears responsibility for the formation of good habits, the cultivation of character, the embrace of tradition, and the discovery of purpose in life. This expanded understanding of education casts light on where family associations come into play in support of his fundamental responsibility. It is essential to remember that those who educate always educate in the name and on behalf of parents. Concrete actions. Indeed, thanks to the knowledge of the situation on the ground and of the concrete needs of the families that compose them and of the tools with which they operate, family associations are able to intervene with local authorities to propose concrete initiatives rooted in the common good, from accommodation, transportation, to the fields of work, leisure, education, community life, health, and environment. By regrouping at the national and European level, family associations become interlocutors of national political authorities, who are able to influence and sometimes even guide the action of the state, which, as Pope Francis points out, has the responsibility to pass laws and create work to ensure the future of young people and help them realize their plan of forming a family. Saint John Paul II, in Families Consortio, had already warned that families should grow in awareness of being protagonists of what is known as family politics and assume responsibility for transforming society. Otherwise, families will be the first victims of the evil that they have done no more than not with indifference. The Second Vatican Council's appeal to go behind the individualistic ethic, therefore, so also holds good for the family as such. Also Gaudium express. In this regard, the particularity of France merits observation. French family policy is to a certain extent effective as is visible in its comparatively high birth rates and robust women's participation rate in the labor market. As a result, French family policy has often been held up as an example, even though for some years now these some policies have entered in a phase of deconstruction. Anyway, since 1935, the National Union of Family Associations, UNAF, is an institutional partner of the French state and one of the main architects of its family policy, a partner that the government and the parliament are obliged to consult on any measure that has a direct impact on the life of families. It must, however, be noted that, unfortunately, this system has not prevented certain drifts in policy and its implementation. Vocation of the Catholic Family Association. The family are the most strongest antidote against the nationalism. And the family associations are at the service of the families, also to promote the inclusion among families and communities from various cultures and traditions. Catholic Family Associations are not only called to address Catholic families, but also to bring their service to everyone. Herein lies their evangelizing force. Indeed, the reference to the Catholic faith is expressed mainly through their political non-pastoral activities, and their proposals are based on the social doctrine of the Catholic Church. The Magisterium of the Church is a rich, global, and coherent source, generally respected as such even by those who do not adhere to it. The social teaching of the Church allows us to reach concrete propositions, Since family associations are humble practitioners of the church social teaching, they celebrate their Christian identity and so stand firm on it like a city built upon a mountain. Catholic social teaching, as the Holy Father told us in 2017, is founded on the dignity of the human person. The way of being family that you want to spread is not subject to any contingent ideology, but grounded in the dignity of the person. On the basis of that dignity, Europe will be able to be truly one family of people. For 25 years, the European Federation of Catholic Family Associations has represented the associations of 18 European countries. Unfortunately, many European countries have yet to form an association of Catholic families. PAFSE's mission is an undertaking of networking, information gathering, and effective inventions at the European institutions to recall, in particular, the fundamental function of the family in our communities and to alert the nations of Europe to the reality of demographic winter we are experiencing now, considered by many to be a real form of suicide of Western societies, as described at the beginning of these days by Professor Dumont. PAFSE organizes, coordinates, and represents family organizations across Europe. Our experience consists of communicating the function of the families vis-à-vis the lobbyists, because the family supports the society as a whole. So, as we said before, we are very our task now is to try to work and to do lobby vis-à-vis the lobbyists, because we have to let them understand that we are a resource also for them. In this way, we do not defend a position, we promote the family as a solution of the social problems. Most importantly, FAFSE does with very limited means. We often say that if every family who shares our values and supports our activities in Europe only gave us €1, we would have much more than we need. With more funds, we could bring the experience of families associations further throughout Europe and wherever they do not yet exist, demonstrating that families are not a problem, but, as I said, a solution and an opportunity. What I said also to the Pope once, that the family association can be regarded as a missionary, because in our experience, in many countries, especially in the East, the family associations help people to be converted in Catholicism, because the beauty of the Catholic family associations can contaminate also the others. And it's also a way to improve the ecumenism, because in Romania, in Ukraine, the Catholic and Orthodox families, they used to pray together. And that's why we could become a real mean also at the service of to conclude, the experience of this year of pandemic, ubi familia, ibi ecclesia and communitas, and as jurists I say use. So during this health crisis, all of us have experienced our family in a fresh and complete way. It was evident how distance from one's family was one of the major causes of suffering. In some way, in this time of war between two European countries, we see how families are the first to help, to welcome, and to support. And what we like really to say is that we said also during this day, and so I don't want to repeat myself, but the loneliness is the worst sickness of our society, and especially for the family, the loneliness is a sickness. Only the family who lives within a RESO network of families could solve this problem. And this is also a way to interpret the function of the church, the priest, the pastors vis-a-vis the families. So this direct connection between the family on one hand and the church and the communitas on the other was clear and in the period preceding the Industrial Revolution. At that time, the family performed a main function at the service of the community by serving its economic and productive nucleus. The family was essential to both the family's members themselves and the entire community, ensuring in a subsidiary way the survival of both. The family took pole position in both situations because it best understood the people involved, their people, their particular needs, and the environment in which they operate. The church, through her shepherd, was at the service of the family, accompanying them and indicating the way of God. The church gave meaning to people's lives in a proclamation of the resurrection and in teaching hope and charity. The concreteness of God was thus experienced by families who became a vehicle of the transmission of the faith and the church. More than that, the relationship of the church with authorities was also based on this role of service of the church towards the family, so much that many pastors also carried out an important function of interpreting the needs of families towards the authority. However, it must be said that between families and the church today as then, help has always been mutual. Families offer vocations to the church. Pastors, thanks to the accompaniment of families, are encouraged to renew with new words the teaching of the good news. With the Industrial Revolution, the family lost its centrality. From being a center of production, it began to perform an instrumental function. The center of the production system was, in fact, not so much in the families as in the factories, to which the families provided a workforce and ensuring high quality human capital. In this context, the church had to manage the ever more absolute power of the state. Where possible, it was in fact the church which often suggested common sense to the rulers on one hand, and to keep the community of families together on the other, thus guaranteeing social peace. Despite the difficulties, and families remained solid, and the church never stopped carrying out her prophetic role of serving as light, souls, living in the world alongside the families, who could always count on pastors capable of not making the families forget the presence of God, consoling them in hope. Challenges of today. In recent past, this role of the church has been more difficult to play. The reason is simple. Families no longer offer only labor, and its members have become consumers, thus giving strength not only to the state, but also to multinational corporations and financial institutions. As a result of this, consumerism has infected our society. The consumption of goods, including drugs, has confused people who are finding it difficult to give meaning to their life. Even the family has no longer been experienced as a place for the realization of the person, a person who has, in that process, become more individual. Our families, even Catholic ones, have remained more and more alone and fragile. Today, in the era of the globalization, the situation has worsened further. Capitalism no longer looks for its workforce in families. Thanks to mechanized manufacturing process and advances in artificial intelligence, the production system does not need that human capital which is formed only in the family. It moves and settles as long as labor is cheap in developing countries. In doing so, these countries will be increasingly exploited, while the families of other countries, lacking decent wages, resort to debt to maintain their standard of living. Precisely because of this ever higher indebtedness, in those countries, families today are not considered useful even to generate consumers of tomorrow. It's not a coincidence that the demographic winter, which has been further worsened by the current crisis, is jeopardizing the future of our society. As a result, the family no longer playing any social and economic role, not even as a consumer because it is excessively indebted, is deemed no longer useful to the production system. It is sad to say, but capitalism today regards the family as a dead branch, as a terminally ill person. Nowadays, big finance looks to the family to exploit it. For instance, it is interested in family savings, which is in some countries, such as Italy, are huge and are considered a treasure to be conquered. Once savings have been lost by more or less legitimate means, the family will certainly not disappear. However, she will not be allowed to carry out an economic and social function in autonomous subsidiary manner, and she will be treated like a stateless person at the margins of the society. Debt removes a family's independence of action. The future of the family is the future of the church. Before this moment arrives, we need to stop and reflect on our future and on the future of families. This must be done now. Indeed, behind sociological, political, economical analysis, one thing is certain. In this context, the alienation, atomization, and indebtedness, the family suffers, and suffers greatly. Above all else, the family suffers because of the loneliness. And if the family suffers, the least of all members of society and the marginalized suffer more. No, as the Pope said, no institution, in fact, can help poor people, orphans, immigrants like families can. But not only that. If the family suffers, the church also. Without the family, the church is without flock. And without the church, the family is without a shepherd. This strong bond is too often taken for granted, both by families and by the church. The first has lost the spiritual dimension due to the secularization. The second perhaps sometimes forget the smell of the flock, also due to objective difficulties such as scarcity of priests or the lack of availability of the families themselves, which make it less easy to have direct contact with the people. Here, in order to recover this bond between the families and church at the end of this long excursus, and after much reflection, as a president of the Catholic Family Association in Europe, I would like to raise the question of a new pact between families and their shepherd. In 2015, in Florence, the Holy Father spoke clearly of a change of era, encouraging all of us to look to the future without fear, remaining united as a people and trusting in the Lord who will lead us on the roads of the world. To achieve this goal, it is necessary to spend our life as a baptized laity, striving to be creative, missionary, recovering in the integral way the reciprocity and understanding of our past. The role of family groups and family association in this change of era. I think that Catholic families, after this period of health crisis, have acquired a new awareness of the necessary role of the pastor. Without pastors, without their guide and their physical attendance, even the Eucharistic risk becoming a virtual rite emptied of its reality and concreteness, as Pope Francis also underlined. However, our pastors cannot be left alone in this very difficult service. Rather, they must be helped to face this discomfort of solitude, accompanying families in closeness, truth, and hope. For this reason, our association will have to play a new role without being afraid of getting their hands dirty and washing the feet of our families, also facilitating the maintenance of that indissoluble unity between families and the Church. Thank you very much.